Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us reflect on our epistle lesson, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, just for a moment this morning. Please sit back, relax, and let us enjoy listening to the word of the Lord just for a moment. Today, our epistle lesson says, rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice. Well, you know what? We rejoice in the Lord for His coming. So that's why, you know, we put up a lot of decorations with great joy. And we are celebrating the Advent season and also coming Christmas season with great joy. So we reflect on that joy. And also, the pink candle on the Advent wreath symbolizes joy. Have you ever observed the lives of the naval officers and naval crew? Maybe we can take a look at the picture. The life of the family of naval officers, petty officers, and the crew are pretty hard, because once they are deployed for patrol, all the crew are on board for minimum three to four months. Sometimes it goes over 6 months on board on the sea. And then when they finish their patrol, and they come back, and then they take rest and they do some maintenance work for about 3 to 4 weeks. That they are deployed again for another patrol. And then they spend 3 to 4 months, or sometimes up to 6-7 months on the sea, and then they come back home again. So just imagine your husband or your loving father leaves home and family in the spring, and then he will come back in the fall. And then he spends time with us for about 3 to 4 weeks, and then go out again in the fall, and then he comes back in the next spring. So it keeps going on and on until he's retired. So the life of the naval officer, a family of the naval officers and crew are pretty challenging and tough. So every time when the naval officers and crew are leaving, or the families gather together at the port beside of the sea, and then they hug each other, and then just they cry, say goodbye dad, and take care, and you take care of yourself, okay? Honey, I love you, and then they leave. And then after spending 3 to 4 months, when they come back, as soon as the ships are at the port, and then the officers and crew begin to come out, the families are waiting for them. And then as soon as they see their father or their husband, they just scream, Daddy! Dad! Honey! And they run, and then they hug each other. Often they cry. They cry. They have tears of great joy for dad's coming, husband's coming, and seeing each other. So actually, seeing this scene at the port of the naval base is very heart-touching, very heart-touching. But when we see that, if we have any chance, we can feel the greatest joy of our fathers coming back home and husbands coming back home seeing again. So actually, we celebrate that kind of joy for our Savior's coming as babe born in the manger. And as we celebrate that kind of joy, leaping joy, for our Savior's coming into your daily life and into my daily life. That's why this morning's epistle lesson says, rejoice in the Lord always. During this Advent season, We have joy for our Savior's coming. We rejoice for his coming in incarnation for us, so that our God, our Almighty God, is truly with you and with me each and every day to life everlasting in his kingdom. This morning, our Lord speaks to us through his servant, St. Paul, the apostle. In our epistle reading, he says, rejoice always. Do you rejoice? And do I rejoice? What do we rejoice for? Why do we rejoice? Well, you know the answer. The answer is, we rejoice for our Savior's coming. Coming of a very important person into our life is absolutely leaping joy. When you met your spouse at first, and then when you get married, you had a leaping joy in your heart because of your loving spouse. And when you got your children, and when they were born as babies, you had a leaping joy. You had a leaping joy in your heart, and you hugged your baby in your arms, and with great joy, you went out for buying diapers, milk, and all the other baby stuff. So that is the joy of loving ones coming. And also we rejoice, and we have that joy because our Savior is coming. Our Savior, Jesus Christ, he is God, and yet he abandoned his highest throne and kingdom, and then he came down so humbly, and he took human flesh, and he was born as a baby, not in a hospital, but in a manger. And he was always with the poor, the sick. He didn't stay with royal families. He didn't stay with the aristocrats. He didn't stay with the rich families. He always stayed with the poor and the sick. And he showed a perfect example of fulfilling God's commandments for us. He showed a perfect Christian lifestyle for us. And then he offered himself on the cross as an atoning sacrifice for our sins and salvation. And through his resurrection, he shattered the power of sin, death, and Satan that used to enchain all of us. And then he poured down his saving grace, his love, in our holy baptism, with a calling the names of each of us. And he made us his precious daughters and sons. That's why we rejoice in the Lord for his coming, for that amazing ministry, and for that amazing indescribable work. He came. He came to us. Of course, sometimes it is not easy to feel his presence with us because we don't see our limited physical eyes. That's why our Savior Jesus Christ instituted and gave us the most amazing gift for us. That is the sacrament of Holy Communion. That is the visible sign. The sacrament of Holy Communion is the visible sign of our Savior's presence each and every day. Whenever we come to the holy altar, kneel down and receive the small piece of wafer and one sip of wine, that is not wafer, that is not wine anymore. It is true and real physical body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. And with giving his precious body and blood, he nourishes us, he feeds us our body and soul, and he strengthens our body and soul, and he gives us his salvation, the power of change and healing. So he continuously and physically come to us through the sacrament of the Holy Eucharist. One of the church fathers, Saint Augustine, said, Christ had himself in his hand when he gave his body to his disciples, saying, This is my body. No one partakes of this flesh before he has adored it. And also another church father, Saint Francis of Assisi, says, What a wonderful majesty, what stupendous condescension, all sublime humility, that the Lord of the whole universe, God and the Son of God, should humble. Whenever we suffer from the issues of the life and the troubles of the life, if you and I come to the holy altar with the most reverence, our Lord faithfully and so humbly comes to you and to me, strengthening and empowering our life with his power and blessings. That's why we rejoice in the Lord every Sunday, and even every day, for his presence with us. Our Lord urges us again through St. Paul in our epistle lesson, rejoice always. Rejoice always. Yes, because of his presence we rejoice, but sometimes it is not that easy because our life is not trouble-free. If we are a member of royal family, or aristocrat, or super rich family, probably our life will be more comfortable, but still, our lives wouldn't be the trouble-free life. Regardless of our social status, the royal family, aristocrats, super rich family, commoner, or very poor people, that doesn't matter. We have to go through all kinds of issues of the life here, but in that, we see hope and we have joy because for us, our Savior is with us always. He watches over us and he guides our life each and every day. That's why we rejoice in the Lord. And actually, we need time and effort to learn for being able to rejoice every day with a diligent study of the Word, prayers, and lots of practices. But once we are able to rejoice, we will see the whole different world. We will see the whole different light in the Lord. Even though we don't have much, we will be happy. We will be able to be happy. Even though we cannot go to the beautiful Caribbean twice, or once, at least every year for our vacation, still, we will be very content and happy. Once we are able to learn how to rejoice in the Lord, then even though our life is not luxurious at all, we will be able to be very content and thankful to the Lord always. And with this, whole different entire world, whole different entire life in the Lord. For the details of that, yes, we need to study, and we need to prayers, and we need to practice. So hopefully we can do that later on. And because our Lord says, rejoice always, I hope that you and I can rejoice for our Savior's coming and our Savior's presence with us each and every day to life everlasting in His kingdom. Let us rejoice. Our Savior is with us. Peace and joy be with you always. Amen. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ, our Savior, both now.